Forget about relaxation when you travel. I want to eat when I travel.
You know I want to eat. Yeah. I mean, I love eating in other countries because it's such a great experience.
Right?
Gabe Saglier from Travel Zoo is here to talk more about how we can actually make that happen. Bon appetit.
I feel like I should have brought some food to share with you guys. But it's true. We're letting our palates lead the way these days. I mean, we know this. We just did a pretty comprehensive survey, though, that now put some numbers behind this idea that food matters. And we're actually using our taste buds to sort of tell us where to go around the world.
And where are most people that you surveyed going to follow their taste bud?
Okay, first of all, 77% of people define themselves as foodies.
Right.
So at the end of the day, whether you really are whether your palate is really refined or not, the fact is that food matters. Mm-hmm. And where we go, we want to eat, and we want to really explore that destination through the dishes on the table. The number one destination that food-friendly people like to go, Italy. Italy was number one. China was number two.
China, really?
China was number two.
Interesting. For the food.
For the food specifically.
Wow.
Yeah. They just call it food there. It's not Chinese food.
Yeah.
That's right. That is true. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner, but surprisingly.
It's just food. Thank you very much. I'll be here all week.
Tip your waiters. Okay.
Half of the people we surveyed said that they actually will look at culinary experiences as a reason to book their travel. So that matters now. More than historical sites, more than other types of experiences, it's what kind of food are we going to get? And almost half would like to do a cooking class when they travel as well.
Half of people want to do that, really. Yeah.
Because really, I think at the end of the day, food is a doorway into culture. It's a doorway into people. See, if you were to travel to Chile, where I grew up, I would tell you about the empanadas that my grandmother used to make and the cazuelas, and then you'd travel and say, you know what? I might want to try some of this stuff that that Gabe was talking about, because really, food is a glimpse into culture, into history, into people. Right. And so, if we want, and at the end of the day, if that's the kind of immersive experience we want, sometimes the easiest way to do it is through the plate.
Right, and it's also a community thing, because when you go to a restaurant, especially if you're from another country, like you start to talk. All of a sudden, I like want to be friends with somebody who's at a table next to me and talk to them where they're from.
Yeah, that's true.
I'm not doing that if I'm going to dinner here in L.A. Right. I'm never going to do that.
Yeah, exactly right. Interestingly, people, as we know, we love to take pictures of our food. We're always snapping.
That's a new thing.
But the number one reason people do that is to keep their friends and family informed of where they are. Only 17% is said that it's because they want to be influencers of whatever type. So at the end of the day, not only are we tasting it and loving it, we want people to kind of get a little bit of a glimpse or taste, even if it's through our social media channels.
Don't be crazy. We want them to be jealous
of us. And we want them to be really jealous of what we're eating. What I think is important about numbers like this is that travel companies now begin to pay attention. Right. So the kind of travel experiences we're exposed to as consumers, the kind of packages that these companies are putting together, now will slowly, I think, start to include more and more these kinds of culinary experiences.
So, this is kind of you talk about risks of the foods that you might, things you would never try, like the crickets in Asia or, the snakes, the things that you might find in other parts of the world. Now, I risked everything to have an authentic fish and chips in London.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, you risked it all there, Carlos.
Wow. Here's what I did. I went searching for, the oldest pub in London.
Right. Yeah.
So what is the oldest pub in London? I Googled it.
Yeah.
It told me which pub it was. I went there and said, I want to have fish and chips in the oldest pub in London. That was a cool experience.
Yeah.
And it was way different than any fish and chips I'd ever experienced. Right. And it was cool. It was really fun.
I did the same thing in Ireland, in Kilkenny. The oldest pub, presumably in Ireland, is in this little town of Kilkenny.
Yeah.
I had fish and chips and a soup.
Yeah.
Sort of down to earth. It was a locals, hangout. Mm-hmm. But the fact that for hundreds and hundreds of years, this very sort of basic regional food had been served there now becomes the kind of experience more and more of us want out of our travels. It's less about just kind of hanging out and letting the days go by. It's more about how much can I consume through these calories, through these flavors, so that I can go back home and tell these stories.
Yeah. Right. So, okay. The other thing I want to talk to you about is because lots of people travel to other countries to go to Disneyland.
Yeah.
Right? Or they don't call it Disney World or whatever it is somewhere else. But they've changed their palate as well. They've changed their food in some of the other places. Yeah, you just went.
And then that's another part of the story.
Is souffle in Paris?
No, it's a plant-based, right?
Disney's gone vegan. Yeah. This is the most comprehensive overhaul of Disney's culinary offerings ever, where at every restaurant at both Disneyland and Disney World, every restaurant will now include several selections of plant-based foods.
And you had it?
I actually tasted through several of them recently at Disneyland. One of the chefs, State, was there. He's one of the several hundred chefs who came together over many months. They've released hundreds of dishes. And, yeah, I mean, I am a bona fide meat eater, but I didn't really miss it because, really, at the end of the day, they're using more plants, vegetables. They're using legumes. They're using nuts to formulate textures. Flavors. And interestingly, the creativity aspect doesn't go away. Depending on what world or land you're in, the food is inspired by that experience, but it's plant-based. They've introduced a new little green logo that you'll see in the menus now, starting in the fall at Disney World and spring of 2020 at Disneyland.
Disney's always forward-looking.
There you go.
And they're always, and the fact that we've got a company that's embracing this movement now, again, is it's an inclusive aspect that really benefits not just the vegan consumer, but for those of us who are just interested in eating something new and exciting.
Trying something new. All right. Gabe Saglia, thank you so much for coming.
Bon appetit.
Call a Disney Paris and eat a plant.
Yeah, right.
All right, we'll be back.